Welcome to Incognito, the podcast, where I converse with interesting guests from a variety of fields and disciplines about how they foster inclusive workplaces and communities. My guest today epitomizes the term improvisation. Not only is Dionna a teacher of improv, but her life story is one full of expecting the unexpected. One of the many ways in which she describes herself is that of a spirit who is a work in progress. But that and other identities all seem so confining to her. She's such an inspiration and optimist that she talks about a particular harrowing experience as a 2.5-year grad school stint. The mantra that kept her going throughout that difficult time was, "We're all the same, only different." I think you'll find this episode full of inspiration and improvisation. Welcome to Incognito, the podcast. I'm your host, Michael Fosberg, and with me today is Dionna Griffin-Irons, and she is a writer, adjunct professor at DePaul and UIC, and the longtime former director of talent diversity and inclusion for the Second City U.S. and Canada. For two decades, she instituted and expanded Second City's diversity, inclusion, and belonging efforts by recruiting, producing, and bringing underrepresented voices in improv and comedy. She has facilitated well over 200 workshops for corporations and organizations, including Embassy Norway and Latvia, using improvisation as a creative tool for innovation, social justice, and belonging. Her TEDx talk detailing her story of meeting women behind bars has been featured with the University of Chicago, WBEZ, and Huffington Post. Her signature class, I love this, Telling Your Truth, is offered year-long for professionals and creatives throughout the year who are seeking to tell their greatest story. Dionna, welcome to the podcast.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Thanks for having me, Michael.
So good to have you, to talk to you. I relate. There's so many wonderful things in your bio that I relate to and that I think about. And then I also, we've talked a little bit offline about this idea of how we define ourselves, who we are, obviously bios being, more of a list of our accomplishments than who we really are. And so the question that I pose to you is, how do you see yourself? What are the identities that are core to how you see yourself in the world?
Oh my goodness, that's such a great question. Identities. I do believe that we are ever evolving as human beings.
Yes, indeed.
And my identity as daughter, as actor early in my career has evolved because now I'm a mom, and then you get into the career roles. So you assume those identities, director, writer, adjunct, professor, educator, all these things. And they can be confining a bit. Yes. And so I do believe that I like to hold on to the human woman identity and latch onto my gender because I gave birth. And so I'm gonna hold on to that gender identity.
Okay, mom.
Right. And then the other, I have to say that it is probably based on my art, being an artist. And that is a huge identity, the artist and the writer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The other ones, I just kind of say, I'm a work in progress. I'm a spirit who's just a work in progress. I would also say, and we can probably dig into this, given my adventurous romp through so many different spaces, not only the theater world, but also behind the scenes and behind bars, I've had many other identities and labels that were thrust and put onto me. And I had to use so much resistance to claim who I really was, particularly when there was an outside institution or entity and a world trying to put a label. So I am so sometimes anti-label, except for I have to use them for whatever the environment or the audience is.
Yeah. Gosh, I want you to talk a little bit about you mentioned being in lots of different spaces, including behind bars, and I want you to talk a little bit about that experience, and maybe that also feeds into the next question, which is, have you ever felt walking into a room that your identity was or might be an obstacle?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I think the biggest one as an obstacle is when I don't even know, and I don't hold on to this a lot, but it did flash in my head about being a statistic. And there's a lot as women, as a person of color, that, you know, as someone who has graduated from college, there's an expectation, a family expectation of that we're trying to always rise above what the past generation did, our family, and for sometimes, you know, for the race, other women, for other people of color.
Expectations. And, yes. Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And so I think, you know, it definitely felt like an obstacle when I was otherized by not being a part of certain groups. And I felt that othering as a young girl who had a bully. I felt that othering in the workspace, not being a part of the white boys club.
Yeah.
I felt the othering not being a part of the clique, the theater clique group.
Yeah.
And even for good stuff, you know, you're othered if you're on the National Honor Society. It's like, oh, there's those are those kids.
Right.
So that is when I feel like my identity has been an obstacle, when I've been othered by other people or an institution because of the social dynamics that exist.
Yeah. Yeah. That's such a pernicious thing in our society to other people. I think because in many ways, we're kind of siloed in our own individual bubble silo, our own core. And yet, unless we look outside of that, there's all this fear of the other and othering people in that respect, because I don't understand them, or I don't know them, or I don't take the time to ask questions or get to know them, right? So let's talk a little bit about, you have a remarkable TED talk about your experience, which I'm not even gonna say what it is. I'm gonna let you sort of give a little something. I mean, you've told this so many times, I'm sure, but for listeners, if you could just give us a little, because this also, you know, sort of talks about, I guess, in a way, which is the next question, which is how you go about creating an environment that's conducive to collaboration, which you needed to do in that particular situation. So share with listeners what I'm alluding to here.
Sure. In my 20s, I fell upon an adventurous ride that took me behind bars. In short, I fell in love with a crook. I picked up his mail. I have the Orange is the New Black story. Huh. The identity that I had before going into a behind the bars situation was I was an actor, an improviser, a comedic actress, if that, you know. And all I had was my art, my theater, those comedic improv skills that I had to use behind bars to survive, to fit in, to find my way, to get back to one. It was, at the time when it happened, it was such a mind-blowing experience, because, you know, you never think that, you know, it's going to happen to you. And yet here I was, someone who had said yes so many times to other people, and in this particular situation, to this kingpin boyfriend of mine, I said yes when I should have said no. And by yes,
you were taught in improv, yes and.
That's right. I was taught. And that's a flip. That's a flip side that I had to relearn. You know, how saying yes to myself can sometimes mean saying no to others. Mm-hmm. And so I take this journey, you know, I take this journey behind bars because the verdict came back guilty. I had a whole year with this dark cloud and the secret that hovered above me, like, oh, am I going to go to jail? What's going to happen? Is it going to happen to me? And of course, you know, they did not get him, so they got the next best thing, and that was the girlfriend and anybody that was connected. That's how conspiracy works. And this was a drug crime. Never used drugs, but at this particular time, I picked him up. I was a mule. And I can laugh about it in so much, because this happened like over 20 years ago. Yeah. But I'm not making light of the situation of this adversity that was really super up. I mean, it turned my world upside down.
Yeah.
And I went in with an optimist attitude when I wasn't in my emotion, that I needed to tap into my improv, my theater, and to teach women, and not only help free them, but to help free myself. Mm. And so I taught improv exercises. I put on shows, and that was really the catalyst. That work behind the bars, yeah. Working with women, it was in a minimum security, was really the catalyst for my belonging, my outreach and inclusion work that became my life work, because I got a chance to work with people who were, I originally assumed were different than me, but then I understood from Jane, who said that we're all the same, only different. Mm. And I know you can totally relate to that. You know, this was someone I had met in Wayne County, and who didn't have her GED. She had been in and out of jail, in and out of jail. And she just looked at me one day and said, you know, Dionna, we're all the same, only different. And that was a mantra that I held on to me, that I held on throughout the entire journey, as I taught classes, as I connected with women from all walks of life, that shaped my understanding about what belonging is, what inclusion is. I hope that answered.
Oh my gosh. Yes, absolutely. It's just so, having listened to your TED talk and hearing this now, it's just so mind-boggling, and yet it's so inspiring. This path that you, the optimism that you brought to the situation, the yes and that you brought to this situation, even though it got you in trouble, to get, that brought you to that situation, is just really inspiring. So I'm going to ask you, and it may be particularly something that happened behind bars, or it may be in another situation, but can you talk about a challenging situation that required unifying efforts on your part, and how you overcame that challenge?
Definitely my experience behind bars in every location, 6 months in Wayne County, my time in Kentucky.
Oh my gosh.
Boot camp, Bryan, Texas. And even the little small 2 weeks in Oklahoma, which is the holding place where you get transferred from one location to a longer location. All of those environments, I taught improv, and I connected with, believe it or not, a fellow Virgo on an airlift ride. Her name's Valerie. I connected with this wonderful human being who, it's interesting how you get connected with like-minded people, and you would never think, like, in this place of all places, on an airlift in shackles, I'm sitting in shackles, that, you know, you connect with someone and say, hey, let's teach while we're away. Let's teach improv, and let's work together. And so she ended up being, she had a wonderful gift of playing music and writing songs and shows. She did the underscore for all the shows that I created. So I did have a collaborator for when I needed music, for to help put that underscore for the shows. Yeah. But that was a huge challenge of finding my way.
Yeah.
Finding my way and getting back to my voice. The other challenge would be arriving to Chicago, $60 in my pocket, starting over, and arriving on the steps of the Salvation Army in a new city. And all I had was, you know, a few contacts, and I had a job. Luckily, I had a job waiting for me with the institution that I had started with in comedy. And I had my whole life ahead of me, where I had to do A through Z. so many different steps to get back to a normal life. And we're not talking, I wasn't gone, you know, a long, long amount of time, but still, anytime that you're separated, it's still in a different environment with restrictions and having to adjust. It is a big change. I just remember when I, and this is like over 20 years ago, but I remember when I first got to Chicago and going to a grocery store, I'm like, oh my God, the colors, it's too much, all these shelves. It was just too much to kind of take in. But the challenge was starting my life over with a new mindset, with a new way of looking at freedom, a new way of approaching work, a new way of connecting with people was the challenge, and how I think I had to build a program. I eventually, you know, had the opportunity to build a program that became my 20-year career at the Comedy Institution, became my life's work. That was a huge challenge. I had to prove and build, here is a vision of how I think we can start to build community and bring new underrepresented voices to the forefront here. Here's how we can change the perception of a whites-only institution and make it better. Here's the incremental programming. Here's what people need to see, in my opinion, because I started off as an actor. Yeah. Here are the things that I think that need to be seen and what I would want as an actor. Let's demystify the industry and answer questions that artists or the community may have before they even arrive. And that was the challenge that became pretty much my core philosophy on how I approach work and inclusion and belonging.
It's wonderful. Yeah. Bringing new voices to the table. Yeah, absolutely. When you describe your reintegration into society, it just reminded me, I don't know if you remember the name. It was the Catherine Bigelow movie that won the Oscar for Best Director. It was about the bomb diffuser in Iraq. And when he came back to America, he went to the grocery store, and there's this long shot of him looking down an aisle in the grocery store and just being completely overwhelmed.
Yes.
By the things, items, choices, etc. And I just felt that so deeply when you described the colors and everything of when you went to the grocery store. It's just so powerful. So thinking about this and building something that's sustainable and bringing new voices to the table, I know that you're using improvisation for a lot of this work, but how do you go about forging new connections with people in the workplace or outside in your community? I mean, it may be a particular method like we described, like yes and, or maybe not. Or are there other methods or techniques or approaches or habits or rules that you abide by to create that inclusivity for people?
There is a lot of yes and, for sure. I think because I started in this work as an improviser, you know, I think I listen, I observe, I experience like an improviser. And what that means is I'm looking for the cues in environment. I'm looking for not only the cues in the environment, but the cues that exist on people when people enter a space. And a lot of times what I noticed moving to Chicago, a lot of people do not like to make eye contact. Yeah. I stayed in Lakeview for over 5 years. And I mean, I would walk my dog and just people avert their glances. They don't make eye contact. They don't look at each other. They look down at the ground. So communication with eye communication is huge. So I'm always looking for when I can pick up and connect with another human being. I'm looking to see other people because I see myself. And that's a huge philosophy that, you know, a lot of times you'll hear people say in this work, in the industry, you know, we want to be seen, we want to be heard. A lot of that has to start first with self. First, take care of self. See yourself. That is self-esteem. That is the confidence in taking care of what I'm going to bring to the table, what I'm going to bring to the moment, what I'm going to bring to a scene. I'm going to give myself something to do. And then by taking care of myself and then extending help to someone else, mirroring them, inviting them, making an offer, giving a gift, and that gift can be metaphorical in any kind of way that you want. Giving a gift is a compliment. Giving a gift is helping someone across the street. Giving a gift is opening the door. Giving the gift is giving instructions. Giving the gift is when someone enters your workspace, your institution, you acknowledge them and you see them. But you have to be whole and have good self-esteem within yourself in order to acknowledge someone else.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of times we're expecting others to do the work. Oh, I want to be seen. I want them to, you know, and we want to take the burden off of ourselves. And first, you know, this is a two-way street. Indeed. It's not just on another person to recognize and to see you. This is something that happens. It's like synchronicity. It's energy. We're all energy beings walking through, living and having an experience on this planet.
Yeah.
And when we become more self-aware of what is happening around us, then I like to think that when we become awareness will help to cultivate compassion.
Mm.
Awareness will cultivate compassion, but we're so distracted that our brains are turned off. We're tuned in to our iPods, our earbuds, you know, we're tuned out. We want to stay in our bubble. We want to stay where it's safe. And there's nothing miraculous, you know, that can happen just by staying in a safe place.
You know that full well, being an improvisation person. Absolutely. I always use the term, I'm sure we've heard this many times, but get comfortable being uncomfortable.
Yes. And here's the thing, given where, now again, my experience was a 2.5 year experience. That was not the totality of my life.
Yeah.
I take it as grad school. You know, I had grad school that took me into an environment. I look at it like that because I was writing every day. I was meeting people. I was playing games. I was teaching. I was doing everything just in a confined setting.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's like, that environment really, when you are pushed into an uncomfortable setting, when you are pushed with an obstacle, that's when you discover who you really are. Teachers can go in with a plan, with a curriculum, you know, professionals can go in to a workspace with an agenda. But where the work really happens is when when something goes wrong and we have to go off of that agenda, we have to go off of the curriculum, then we go into discovery and we're really connecting. And so coming from that environment, you know, having that background, being in boot camp, being in a confined situation, it was fodder and a great foundation for me to always expect the unexpected.
Yeah, that's absolutely true.
Yeah. And I think that's the only way that we grow and evolve as humans.
Yes. Yes. So I, as a teacher, I often feel that I am learning so much in my class, in my classroom, because, and I often say, when I stop learning, that's when I need to stop teaching.
Right.
You know, right. Because I think, yes, it's sort of thought of or accepted that the teacher is the one with all the knowledge and bringing everything to the classroom, but actually, it's kind of the other way around in many degrees. It's the students that are bringing it and bringing new things to the table, which is then helping the teacher inspire, and it's sort of cyclical.
Yes, it's having the teacher to pull out things out of their toolbox.
Right.
Oh, okay. I need to apply this. Oh, this student needs this. If I'm just using one method for all students and assuming that everyone is going to learn, we all don't learn at the same, we don't learn the same way.
That's right. That's
and
right.
And we all process knowledge in different ways. So we should be adaptable in that way as well.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. All right. Here's a big question. We all perceive definitions to particular words slightly differently. And of course, we come to the table with our own set of, you know, biases. But if I were to ask you what it means to be authentic, how would you describe that? And what does that look like for you?
Oh, man. Authentic. Being authentic is leaning into your unapologetic truth. Your unapologetic truth of who you are, where you've come from, where you are right now, and where you hope to be. It's also not censoring yourself and not putting your answers in a way that, in a way of what we think other people want to hear, or what the expectation is. And that's this whole process of life. I believe that's a whole process of this journey, is to get back to our truthful, authentic selves. Because as a child, we go through so much conditioning, not only from our parents, from our environments, from the world, from everything that we're consuming, and we're absorbing so much. And then there comes a point in our life, it's like, wait a minute, I have to peel back these layers. Like, what is the truth? I mean, my truth was, wait a minute, it's like, I have a voice. In my 20s, I had to understand that I have a voice and that I can say no. You mean I don't have to please other people? I get to say no and be okay with it? You mean if I would have just said no, that I didn't even have to go on this journey at all?
Yeah.
If I would have just believed in myself and my own voice, but somewhere in my belief system and my conditioning, and I think it's the whole, it's part of what I absorbed and what I experienced, I thought that I had to go along with what the other wanted.
Yeah.
That I, you know, that I, oh, that's not being a good girl, or that's not being nice, that's not being acceptable. So I think part of the journey, and this is an ongoing process, no matter, I believe, wherever you are, whatever age you are, you know, if you want to come to this awareness that authenticity has to become, you know, a part of being truthful and honest with yourself, and knowing that you have a voice and that you don't have to apologize, not for this beautiful, brilliant life that we have on this earth.
Yeah.
We don't have to apologize for anything, and we don't have to color it. We don't have to package it. We get to be all of who we are and what we want to express, and what, within good reason. Cause of course some people go off on, that's a whole other, you know.
Well, there's a thing, deal of respect is important.
Yes.
Right.
Dignity.
I'm struck by what you said earlier about following some paths sometimes that aren't a part of who our authentic selves are. And I think a lot about young people these days, especially high school students, who find themselves in situations in which maybe they're like, well, how did I wind up here? Why did I go off and do this thing with this group of people? Because the pressures, especially for young people, are so, so powerful and so difficult to navigate. I'm just curious, being a mother with teenagers, how do you go about helping them understand their authenticity?
Yeah, I'm doing my best to foster love of self, so that they don't have to look outside of themselves for love, recognition, and validation.
Mm.
Because I think that when we look up, that's where the problem is. We're seeking love and validation. Recognition. We're seeking it again. I want to be seen. I want to be heard.
Right.
Who's going to give me the attention? You know, is it the toxic relationship? Is it the gang? Is it the social circle? Is it this? I want to fit in.
Yeah.
Again, it's these circles that we're trying to be accepted. And I'm saying, you know, let's try to accept ourselves 100%, little by little. And it's a process.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wonderful. This is really great. Thank you so much for this conversation. I want to ply you with one last thing. If we could help listeners with a recommendation that you might have for something that's inspiring you, maybe a book, a movie, a play that has inspired you recently and why?
Oh, wow. There's so many books. Right now, I'm doing a lot of Toni Morrison, reading about her writing process.
Oh, wow.
I love her work. So if anyone wants to kind of Google Toni Morrison writing process, you will find so many gems. Watch any of her interviews where she talks about just the imagination at work, how she talks about racism being a distraction, how she talks about who she's writing for and trying to, you know, eliminate this voice of one color inside of, and she said, like the white man voice that's inside. There's so much. But yeah, Toni Morrison, if you can soak up any of Toni Morrison's work, Roxane Gay's work.
Yeah.
Highly, highly recommend. I teach a comm lit class using a lot of Roxane Gay essays.
Excellent. Terrific writer also. Yeah. Yeah. And of course, Toni Morrison's books being banned in schools across the country. Crazy.
Wow. Right. Yeah.
Yes. Look, but I couldn't agree with you more. I've heard many interviews with her and read books and just can't get enough. It's great.
Yeah. I think, you know, as writers, and you know this because you're a writer, you know, we're passing the torch, we're lighting the way, yeah. And we're trying to tap into the mystery and that calling and that tiny voice that we hear and share it. So, yeah. So as from fellow writer to writer, it's like, you know, keep doing the great work, Michael. I'm an admirer of your work and your writing. And there's just much to cast out in the world. And I think it's just absolutely awesome about how you have us telling our stories and sharing a little glimpse of our lives to connect all of us.
Well, thank you so much for that. And thank you so much for this conversation.
Thank you.
Thanks again for listening to Incognito, the podcast, season 4. If you're a new listener, welcome. I hope you found something here that you can use in your work life or your community. And if you are returning, I'm so happy to continue to have your support. I personally listen to a good number of podcasts and realize how difficult it can be to sustain listenership over time. So for those of you who can call yourselves longtime listeners, I really appreciate that you still find value and interest in what is being said here. As always, we welcome your suggestions and encourage you to rate and comment in your podcast app. Ratings and comments help people find us and allows us to spread the word about this work. Also, you can find us on Instagram at incognitotheplay. Find us there, follow us, hit us up with a question or a comment. We have a limited social media presence, so I'm urging you to take an additional step to tell someone you know about this work. I'll be back again next week with yet another conversation that delves deeply into identity, authenticity, and ways in which we can create inclusive communities and workspaces.